everyone, and welcome to At Home with the Bay. My name is Cindy Willems, and I am the Director of Education for the Galveston Bay Foundation. We are so excited to bring you this series of virtual field trips. Each video will include virtual labs and field trip activities, a conservation craft, talks with bay biologists, and an outside activity that you can safely participate with. Today's topic is Galveston Bay biodiversity. How many animals do you think live in the bay? We're here today at Galveston Bay Foundation's Trinity Bay Discovery Center, where we hold a lot of field trips during the school year. We want to bring you with us today to learn more about the animals of the bay using a seine net. Come on, let's go. All right, so this is a seine net, and this is one way we use to catch fish and shrimps and crabs out here on the bay. On the seine net, you'll notice it has floats on the top, and then on the bottom, there are sinkers, and the sinkers allow it to go straight to the bottom and stay at the bottom. That way we can find all of the good animals that like to hang out in the sand, like shrimp and flounder and little baby crabs. All right, looks like we got a lot of great things in here. Come on, girls, take a look. Before we touch the fish, we always need to make sure we wet our hands because we don't want to get their mucus layer off of their skin. So here we have a blue crab. So blue crabs are one of the predominant crab species that we can find in the bay. And you can notice that his last thing of legs are paddles. You see how they're flat and they're big? It allows him to swim, and it also allows him to dig in the mud. And you can see underneath, you can always tell a crab if he's male or female by looking at the underside of his belly. I'm gonna try to make sure that he feels very safe with me. Can you see? Can you see how right here it's pointed? This middle piece is pointed. That means he's a male crab. We're gonna go ahead and put him in here so he stays nice and safe. Can you see him in there? Next, what else do we have, guys? What else did you find? There's some fish and shrimp. All right, now if we take a look at our fish, ladies, things that we want to notice is the shape of his body. And I'll turn him around a little bit. Here we go. So you can see he's got a curved upper, that's the dorsal side, and then he has a flat ventral side.
I think he kind of looks like Spot.
Kind of looks like a Spot. His mouth, you see, is kind of underneath him like that. And then his tail, kind of hard to tell here, but his tail looks a little kind of flat at the end. And you guys can see right here, this is called his lateral line. Can you say lateral line?
Lateral line.
And the lateral line allows him to feel vibrations in the water. Now, while Bella's holding that Spot, we have another fish here, Gracie. Do you want to hold this one?
Sure.
Okay, so then let's take a look and see if we can figure out which one he is. All right, see, look how big his belly is. He's kind of the opposite of the Spot. See how his dorsal side is kind of flat and his ventral side is nice and kind of round and poofy. I'm gonna say, can you tell which one he is? Kind of, but do you see how he's got even more of a belly right here? Which other one does he look like? That's right, that's a Gulf menhaden. And we see lots of Gulf menhadens around here. They love to live in our marshes. Excellent. Okay, so here we have lots and lots of shrimp. Shrimp love to live in the marsh grass because it gives them a nice place to live and raise their babies. And you can see here we have a little shrimp, and it's very hard to tell the difference between marsh shrimp and brown shrimp. But I'm thinking that this is a brown shrimp. But one thing you can see is that this shrimp is a female, and I can tell it's a female because she has all of her eggs right here. She holds her eggs with her little legs called swimmerettes, and she'll hold onto her eggs until they're ready to hatch. She's taking care of them. Isn't that really cool?
Yeah, that's so cool.
Wasn't that fun? There are so many exciting and important animals that live in the bay. You'll find out more about them with our bay biologist coming up next.
Hi, my name is Dr. Erin Kinney, and I'm a research scientist with HARC, working on the Galveston Bay report card. Today, I want to talk about Galveston Bay. And one of the things that makes Galveston Bay strong, healthy, and resilient is its biodiversity.
What is biodiversity? It's short for biological diversity, and it means the variety of different types of plants, birds, animals, bacteria, and everything else that lives in an ecosystem. What's an ecosystem? An ecosystem is made up of all the living and non-living things in an area. This includes all of the plants, animals, and other living things that make up the communities of life in that area. So the Galveston Bay ecosystem is the water, sunlight, dirt, plants, insects, animals, and every other living thing in the bay. Why is biodiversity in an ecosystem a good thing? Well, the more variety of plants and animals we have in Galveston Bay, the more habitat and food choices are available for the things that live there. Here's an example. When Hurricane Harvey dumped so much rain on Galveston Bay and its rivers and bayous, tons of fresh water ended up in the bay, way more fresh water than normal. So much fresh water that plants, animals, and fish that prefer salty water had to leave or died. And those animals, like certain fish, were not available as food for birds and dolphins and other species in the bay. So the birds and dolphins needed something else to eat. Without a variety of species in Galveston Bay, it would have been much harder for those birds and dolphins to find something to eat during that time. Now, over time, the bay recovered from the stress of Hurricane Harvey, and it was the biodiversity of the ecosystem that helped make that recovery possible. So, what biodiversity would you put in your backyard ecosystem?
Hi guys, my name is Emily.
And I'm Karen.
And today we're going to show you how to make your very own backyard biodiversity diorama. So let's get started by talking about the supplies that we're going to need for this. Tara, would you like to help me with that?
So first we're going to need a small box like a shoebox, and we're also going to need some scissors to cut. We're going to need some glue and tape to glue the things in our diorama box. And also we're going to need some markers to color the things we need.
Awesome. You're also going to need to get online to search for and print some pictures of animals that you find in your backyard whenever you go out exploring, and we'll get to that in just a moment. You'll need a reusable bag to collect your leaves and twigs that you find in your backyard to put in your diorama. You'll also need a notepad and a pen so that you can write down the animals that you see in your backyard while you're exploring. So the very first thing that we're gonna do is go to our backyard, start looking for some different leaves and sticks, and we're gonna find out what kind of animals we have in our backyard. You ready to go?
Yeah.
All right, let's get our bag and go. Okay, so we got all of our animals colored and cut out. We have all of our collection from the backyard. Now it's time to get our box ready to become a diorama. How do you want your box to be set up? Do you want it to be flat like this, or do you want it to be up and down? It's up to you. I'm gonna keep ours flat, and I'm also gonna cut the top off and some of these extra parts here so that more light can come into the box.
Thank you.
Okay, now we're ready to get started on building our biodiverse backyard diorama. Are you ready, Taryn?
Yep.
All right, so the first thing we're gonna start with is all the cool stuff that you collected from the backyard, and let's see if we can make a little tiny habitat in here. You ready?
Yep.
Okay, so we've created our habitat with the different rocks and sticks and leaves that Taryn found. Now it's time to add our animals to the diorama. So when you're adding your animals, think about where you saw them when you were in the backyard. Was the butterfly flittering around flowers? Was the lizard maybe on a fence hunting for bugs to eat? Was the bee flying around some flowers? Just keep all that in mind when you start to put your animals in your diorama.
My name is Mariah, and today I'm going to show you a really fun way to find out what kind of plants and animals you might have in your backyard, or even your front yard. This activity involves using a really cool app that you can download onto your phone, your tablet, or your iPad. Make sure you have a parent or an adult to help you with this part.
The app is called Seek. Head to the App Store and type in Seek by iNaturalist, and it should be one of the first apps to pop up. Hit download. When you first open the app, it'll ask if it can use your location. Enabling this will allow the app to show you what species are nearby in your area. It will even give you background information on the species. Let's take this blue jay, for example. It will tell you facts, the taxonomy, the time of year you're most likely to see it, and species that are related. The app also has challenges you can participate in and badges you can earn. You can do them by using the camera through the app and completing the tasks to gain achievements.
So that's a little bit about the Seek app. Now let's go see what we can find in the backyard.
You want to make sure you scan multiple angles of what you're trying to identify. This way, the app will give you the most accurate result. This flower is called China Rose. And look, we just earned our first badge.
I hope you enjoyed this activity and found this app to be a lot of fun. A lot of us at the Galveston Bay Foundation use it, and we can't wait to see what kind of species you discover.
Had so much fun today. We went sailing and identified organisms in the marsh.
And learned more about the biodiversity found in Galveston Bay.
We also made backyard dioramas.
And learned how we can learn more about the animals in our backyards and neighborhoods by using the Seek app.
We'll see you next time when we learn more about the microscopic ecosystem. Bye!